As I said, my name is Barry Black. I'm Special Agent Bomb Tech. I've been in the Bureau a little over 19 years. And what Wes has asked me to discuss today was a block on improvised explosives, the basic introduction to explosives, as well as post-blast and evidence collection. Each one of those is generally a block of instruction of its own, and we're going to kind of compress them into about an hour. So it's going to be tip of the iceberg kind of stuff, but if you have any questions, just give me a call. The definition is not critical. Basically, it's going to be some type of a compound or a mixture that is not happy in its present state. And when it changes, it evolves into something different that's usually exponentially larger in volume, production of a tremendous amount of gases, heat, shock, and sound. It's going to change its chemical makeup if we're talking about a chemical explosive. We'll often discuss explosives and describe them by their detonation velocity. That's just a way to measure, if you will, the strength of an explosive. When an explosive initiates, that change begins to occur. Different types of explosives will say decompose at a different rate. TNT happens to be the standard, kind of arbitrary standard, and its detonation velocity is 22,600 feet per second. So everything else is usually given in terms as a function of TNT. You've all heard on the news, you know, the bombs dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, they were given in either megatons or kilotons, depending on the type of device we're talking about. That's gives you a corresponding relationship to its power as related to TNT. There's basically two types of explosives, high explosives and low explosives. Again, there was a somewhat arbitrary line drawn to distinguish the two. Low explosives will detonate, or we'll talk about deflagration shortly, at under 3,300 feet per second. So again, it's the speed of conversion. Those are things like black powder, smokeless powder, other types of mixtures. For improvised powders, you don't need a real chemical combination. You take a little bit of this, a little bit of that, you know, kind of gently mix it together, and they're true mixtures. Whereas with chemical compounds, you have two distinctly different materials that when combined become chemically different. This is it's called a powder burn, black powder, smokeless powder. You can see, you put a match to it and what happens? Burns. All right, it burns very, very rapidly. That's called, you know, deflagration, just for a word of the day. But you also see it's giving off a pretty high volume of gas. There's heat, there's smoke, but unconfined, these powders will burn. Now, what happens if you put those powders inside a container? It's like your crock pot or the old steam boilers. If you close that relief valve, there's no place for that pressure to go, and it'll eventually rupture the container it's in. And that's, we'll talk about mechanical explosions in a moment. High explosives on the other end detonate at a greater velocity, at least 3,300 feet per second, up to approaching 28,000 feet per second for things in like detonating cord for RDX. They're usually a chemical compound, and you know how they're made up is not as critical as, you know, what they are. That's your dynamite, C4, trinitrotoluene, the TNT. You have to treat them all basically with respect. The mechanical explosion, the types of explosives or explosions that can occur, mechanical explosion. The most common IED in this country still is a pipe bomb. Everybody thinks, you know, it's going to be a steel pipe. May not be. Could be PVC. Could be a CO2 cartridge from a pellet gun. Basically a pipe bomb. All that is a container that contains usually a mixture of smokeless powder or black powder. And as that begins to burn, when heat, shock, or friction is introduced, that volume of gas that's produced overcomes the structural integrity of the container that it's in, and it ruptures. So we can see now that if something like dynamite were placed in a steel pipe, as opposed to black powder placed in a steel pipe, the damage done to the pipe and the surrounding area would be significantly different. So that's really what we're going for in just a broad brush, is the difference in high and low explosives and their capability. The most common type of explosive commercially are compounds. As I mentioned, those are two or any number of distinct and different entities that are combined and become something different chemically. When a sufficient amount of shock is introduced to those compounds, they break apart at a molecular level that give you the energy release, again, with a lot of noise, heat, and shock. Then the bigger ones that we aren't going to talk so much about are nuclear fission and fusion. That's a whole other problem. There are a series of steps that have to occur in order for an explosion to what's called high order. A high order explosion is one that performs as it's intended to. Low order, conversely, is something where it just doesn't go quite right. All the explosive is not consumed, and that can be caused by any number of factors. Sometimes the issue is the makeup of what's called the explosive train. Now, an explosive train, if you think of a rifle cartridge or bullet cartridge, you've got the primer in the end of the round that's struck by the firing pin or hammer of the weapon. That primer produces a little spit of flame that is introduced to that powder that's inside the cartridge. All right, if that cartridge were, say, welded closed, what would happen? Cartridge would rupture. That's the pipe bomb. But the weakest point in that makeup is where the bullet and the cartridge are actually attached. So as that deflagration occurs, that rapid burning of the powder inside the cartridge, it builds up the gases and starts to force the bullet out of the cartridge assembly and down the barrel. So that's basically a very simple low explosive train. You can translate that into the old firecracker M80. You light a match to the fuse goes in the M80. Again, that's a very simple explosive train. For higher explosives, they require a lot more of a shock. C4 and many military explosives obviously are designed for a battlefield environment. They're ballistic tested. If you've got a pack of C4 on your back and people are shooting at you, it's not a good thing if you get hit by a bullet and they explode. So they can withstand the shock of getting struck by a bullet up to a certain caliber. Yet a blasting cap, which we'll discuss in a minute, has enough shock to cause them to detonate. So an explosive train for high explosives will generally start with some type of detonator. The word detonator and blasting cap are usually interchangeable. And now we're seeing overseas an uptick in improvised detonators. A lot of this presentation, as I said, I took last night from three different blocks, but as ERT personnel, you stand a pretty good chance of being deployed overseas, either to the current theater of operations or elsewhere, and we need to start focusing on what's occurring in other parts of the world so we're not just have those blinders on for what we can expect to see in this country. Again, graphic example of a simple explosive train. Military time fuse is like the hobby fuse you used to use for if anybody had little model rockets when you were a kid. You know, it's the same thing. It's usually a core of black powder wrapped in oftentimes a nylon type of a wrapping. What's sensitive about fusing systems is the time that it takes for them to burn. You know, when I'm setting a charge, I want to know when it's going to explode for a lot of reasons. So how long that black powder core takes to burn a given length is something that we can calculate through doing what's called a test burn. It's nothing you're going to have to know in the field, but that's the reason you'll see at a crime scene a burnt length of test fuse. Generally, they'll be about 3 feet long. That's a pretty good indication that somebody's timing their time fuse to see how fast or how slow it'll burn. It's dependent on humidity, where you are in relation to sea level and several other factors. Blasting caps, y'all have seen these other than movies, I guess. They used to be made out of copper. At that time, they didn't realize that some of the primary explosives that fill blasting caps react negatively with copper and form very hazardous explosive chemicals. So now they're generally going to be made out of aluminum or some type of alloy. There are two types of blasting caps, either non-electric or electric. Non-electric will accept usually time fuse about the size of a pencil. There are different types. They're usually given a number to differentiate their size or strength, if you will. But a non-electric cap will look very similar to this, except it won't have those crimp marks and it won't have the plug and the electrical wires. It's designed to accept one end of that time fuse I've described previously. So again, the spit of flame from that black core enters the open cavity of the blasting cap, and then from here up to what we call the business end is a series of very sensitive primary explosives. When you vacation at the beach, you know, a little hourglass you can buy with the different colors of sand, sort of the same theory. There's a very, very small quantity of extremely sensitive explosive on this end that where that spit of flame from the core will cause it to detonate. Within the cap, there's a small explosive train that occurs, where at the end you get a relatively, these are very small amounts, but by comparison, the end result is much larger than the one at the beginning. So you get a tiny explosive train inside the blasting cap itself. The electrical cap functions the same way, except a current's generated from the blasting machine. Current passes down the electrical wires, and on the plug end is basically a filament, a tungsten wire that heats up. That heat's sufficient to cause the detonation that I previously described. From the blasting cap, depending on your type of explosive, comes the main charge. That's basically just the bulk explosive that you're trying to detonate. A military M112 block of C4 is a pound and a quarter of plastic explosive. Now, if you're making your improvised explosives, which we'll discuss later, they may not have the properties that will allow them to detonate with just the force of a blasting cap. So between the cap and that main charge, you may need what's called a booster. A booster is simply an explosive that will detonate from the shock of that cap with enough violence to cause your main charge to explode. Perfect example is the device that destroyed the federal building here in Oklahoma City. Large quantity of ammonium nitrate and fuel oil, which is basically a blasting agent. It's very, very insensitive, but there were almost 3 tons of it. Introduced into that was several hundred pounds of an explosive booster. The boosters were then linked together with an exploding cord called detonating cord, and then that was in turn detonated with non-electric blasting cap. So, you know, just an explosive train, small to large, with a function of power. So at the scene of an explosion, you know, what really happens? You've got some quantity of an explosive material that's converting in fractions of a second to this roiling mass of hot gas that's expanding exponentially. So the Bikini Atoll atomic tests, everybody's seen those on History Channel, or you had to sit through them when you were in fourth grade. You know, the big white ring that's expanding outward from the seat of that explosion, that's called a shock front. What that is compressed air. It at the time of detonation, explosives will detonate spherically. So at that point, the atmosphere is compressed around the seat of the explosion, and it's rushing outward in a 360-degree pattern. It happens so fast that it actually compresses the atmosphere immediately around it, and it's running out at several hundred to several thousand PSI, depending on the type of shot. Behind that is, it's like a tornado, if you will. That shock front hits things, shatters them, scatters them, but then that leaves a partial vacuum. Well, nature abhors a vacuum, as they say. So then what you'll see is air will tend to rush back in. It's called a negative pressure phase. The former is the positive pressure phase. And what you'll find at large bombing crime scenes, or if you've noticed any of the bombings that have been televised out of Colombia and South America, that always notice the curtains are hanging on the outside of the buildings across the street. Have you all paid that much attention? Maybe not. But that's from that negative pressure phase. Basically, the air is rushing back in to fill that partial vacuum, and it's literally sucking things out of the buildings. The Murrah building, we were finding personal effects from the Y, which was across the street, that had been pulled out of the building from that that negative pressure phase. This is like I think somebody in the 50s came up with these drawings, but you see them in pretty much every presentation similar to this. It's just a depiction of that positive pressure phase. It's very brief, and that's where a great deal of that shattering force comes from. Then the negative pressure phase can last up to four times as long. Again, it's still in measured in seconds and fractions of seconds, but you can see how things are pulled back towards the seat of the explosion. And what we're going to try to do at a crime scene is first of all determine where the seat of the explosion was, and then what evidence we can glean from what we see immediately. Blast effects, as I said, that power is coming out spherically from the point of the explosion, but you can direct or focus the blast, that pressure wave, if you will. This is a device used at the Olympics in 1996. What is this steel plate for? To direct the blast outward. This particular bomb was left on a little knoll at the base of a tower, and the public was facing, if you will, away from the device. So this, the purpose of having a steel plate was to focus or direct that blast outward so that more people would be injured. And if you would kind of remember what we're seeing here, smokeless powder is what, high or low explosive? Low explosive. So it'll burn, right? But what if you put it inside something? What'll happen once that begins to burn and overcome the integrity of that pipe? All right. So this will eventually come apart. The pipes themselves will come apart. If, say, this clock is sitting on top of the pipe when it comes apart, what's going to happen to the clock? It'll come apart also, right? Because of near proximity to the explosion. Well, all of these things combined make up the bomb, make up the device. So parts of the device are commonly referred to as fragmentation, because you know the package itself is fragmenting. Now, these masonry nails, is that part of the container, part of the package of the device, or is that something else, something extra? Extra. It's shrapnel. That's right. So we'll hear terms, you know, short fragmentation, shrapnel. Generally, when you start seeing shrapnel, things added, that's designed to do more damage. And generally, it's designed to do more damage to people. There are devices, particularly for military applications, with it, shrapnel is designed to defeat armor, for instance, and other hardened targets. But generally, in an IED, particularly when you start seeing shrapnel, things added to enhance the effects of the blast, you can begin to presume it's an anti-personnel device. As I said, primary frag is part of the device coming apart. Most people, particularly in vehicle-borne IEDs, are killed from secondary fragmentation. That is, the glass that's blown out of the windows, the building material, things in near proximity to the device at the point of detonation, they pick up speed, if you will, marginally in relation to those that are immediately a part of the device, but still are a hazard. The thermal effect of a conventional explosive is minimal by comparison. We've set some ranges on fire on and off just because of the heat generated at the point of the explosion. But when you compare the thermal effect, the heat and the fireball generated by what we'll consider a conventional explosion, that impact is negligible when compared to that shock front, the primary pressure phase and the negative pressure phase, the blast effects. Commonly, there are secondary effects that are associated with a blast. This is, we'll go tomorrow, I think, down to the Murrow Building, the memorial. This is the area across the street. That building is currently where the memorial museum is housed. This damage here is representative of secondary blast effects. The gas tanks in the parking lots of the cars across the street were punctured. They were ruptured. The fuel was coming out, and broken electrical wiring can spark fires. All these things are associated with the blast, but they're sort of resultant from the blast. They're not a part of that initial device. Earth and water shock, that the blast at the Murrow Building, for instance, was recorded on seismograph equipment down in Norman, which is about 60 miles away. Water, detonations in water doesn't compress, so that shock wave will propagate, will go a lot farther underwater. You know, and again, you have to start thinking about secondary effects when you're arriving on scene, like ruptured gas lines half a block away, a block away. And that's some of the intel you need to get as you're beginning to report to a crime scene. IEDs, improvised explosive devices. Again, with the SEXI group we have overseas in Afghanistan and Iraq, we are beginning to successfully identify some commonalities in the IEDs that are used. And we'll discuss those in a little more detail here. But what is it? What is an IED? I mean, your run-of-the-mill IED. That's my point. There's not a run-of-the-mill IED. It can be almost anything between, you know, Radio Shack and Walmart and somebody with a little bit of knowledge. You can make a bomb out of almost anything. You know, the old TV show MacGyver was a pretty good example of that, right? So when you're on a scene, you really do have to, you know, use your head. You have to be suspicious, particularly now. Have you all seen the video of the secondary device that went off at the abortion clinic in Atlanta? The lady, she's giving her interview and there's talking, and then behind the dumpster another bomb explodes. That was unusual in this country. It's not anymore. And we know, you know, history is a pretty good predictor of the future. The PIRA and IRA began to target first responders. Starting to see that in Colombia now, and obviously overseas in the Middle East currently. So you can sort of, not to be paranoid, but think of yourselves as targets. We've done training exercises as well as real world events where we'll show up and there's an indication of a secondary device. You know, we've ended up having to pull back. There are people still in there, and they're thinking, "Hey, I wonder why those guys are leaving." You know, but basically, if we're taken out of play, then who's there to press on? So for your own safety, we now truly must consider secondary and tertiary devices as a real threat. Who would think that's an IED? Looks like a big skull can. Well, this is I believe it's a Russian landmine. And what we're finding, particularly overseas, is there are just caves and warehouses and unfenced piles of military explosive. So if I can get my hands on an artillery shell, but I don't have a tube to launch it from, is it any good to me? Well, it is if I make one of those improvised detonators, bury the shell under the road, and then use a booster, some Simtex, and I've altered it. So now, is that now a piece of military ordnance, or is that an improvised explosive device? It's an IED. We've adapted it. So what we're seeing overseas is all this stuff that's lying around, rockets, mortar shells, artillery shells, landmines, they aren't being utilized in the way in which they were designed to function. They're being altered and then buried under the roads. When we started sending up-armored Humvees overseas that could defend against the blasts on roadside bombs, well, they started putting the devices in the road because there's not as much armor underneath. So there's a learning curve for us and for our enemies. We just have to be aware that when you see something that, you know, we might all say, well, that's clearly a piece of military ordnance, but why is there duct tape and baling wire on it? You know, we cannot assume that it's going to function as it's designed to function. Very basically, we're looking for four parts of an IED. In some form or fashion, these four things are always going to be around. It's going to have some kind of a power source. Now, does that have to be a 9-volt battery? All right, what does a capacitor do? Stores energy, okay? So a capacitor can serve as a power source. What am I if I'm walking through a doorway and step into a tripwire? I'm now a power source. I've caused something to happen. So generally, you know, we kind of think of things as being electronic in nature, and that's not a bad idea. But as far as the components of an IED, just because you don't see all of them and what you might be expecting, it's really not a great idea to determine that it's probably not a bomb. There's going to be some kind of a conductor in an electrical device. That's going to be some type of wiring, because obviously that electrical current has to get from point A to point B, right? It's going to work somehow. Something's got to control the energy on and off, so there'll be some type of switch. It doesn't have to be a toggle switch. It doesn't have to be a switch you buy at Radio Shack. Just something that can interrupt that flow of energy. And then the last thing you'll need is obviously something to explode. This is a quarter pound of TNT. You might want to guess what one of the four of those that is. 9-volt battery, okay. The red and blue things are the connectors or conductors, the wiring. And what's the clothespin for? Okay, and venture a guess what this is with the little string on it? Okay, basically that serves as an insulator. The bare wires or some type of metal contact are piercing the wood of the clothespin, and when the victim separates or removes that insulation, the two contacts touch, circuit's completed, and the TNT would explode. So our switch here is what? Clothespin. You know, you can do it with mouse traps, car alarms. Your conscience can be your guide. They can be very complicated. We've seen devices used in base stations. Like if you go to Outback, they give you a little buzzer. Well, those have a given radius. The bad guys know what those are. And instead of telling you your table's ready, you connect that to 6 or 8 vehicle-borne IEDs, hit the button, you get 8 explosions at once. So we have to begin thinking outside the box. Mail bombs, common, large vehicle bombs. This is a command detonated IED. Now, how far away was that videotaped? Pretty long way. And why is that? Because they're the guys that planted the bomb. This is actually a training video that was captured overseas. These guys realize there's a learning curve. So they want to see how big of an explosion is sufficient to do what we want. How far off do we have to be? Now, how big would your crime scene be? For smaller scenes, is it helpful for, you know, the device, if I'm the bomber and I want to do some damage in here, and you're walking in the room, you see a big ball of dynamite with a clock and batteries and wires, is that really going to help me fulfill my mission? I mean, are y'all going to come on in and have a seat, or are you going to find somewhere else to go? Right? I mean, so a lot of times these containers are designed to do nothing more than conceal the device, not necessarily part of the device other than to camouflage it. This is the type of barrel that Timothy McVeigh used to just to physically contain that bulk ammonium nitrate and fuel oil. It's basically like fertilizer. You got to have something to put it in, and these are the types of barrels he came up with. This will look vaguely familiar, but the plates are for what? All right, direction. And then what are the other things we needed? Those four components of an IED? Power sources. Conductors. And switches. Okay, so these are what would cause this device to function based on what you see here?
Time.
So generally we can infer from this at least that it's a time device. What else can we infer? Well, you can generally start thinking it's going to be an anti-personnel device. They're trying to direct the blast in one particular way, and there's shrapnel added for that little something extra. And what's the container in this device? Why is it parked in a curve? You got to slow down. Every day, almost every day, is what we're finding overseas. So why are we doing this? I mean, why are y'all here for this little hour of talk and conversation? Why process a crime scene? What's our ultimate goal? There's a clue. Try to find out who did it and prosecute them or bring them to some other just resolution, right? So, seat of an explosion, what can you expect to find? Is it all just destroyed and there's no point in looking? I just came back from just near the border in Malaysia, and it was hot, just Tarzan jungle kind of hot, and we were doing some training with some of the counterterrorism folks there. They took a spade or two of dirt, sifted, you know, a couple of cubic feet, and said, there's nothing here. I said, let's try just a little bit longer. A couple of more shovels went through, and they started finding the components. Then all of a sudden, it was interesting and fun. But bombing crime scenes are extremely protracted. They're manpower intensive, they're time intensive, and a lot of it is just absolutely boring, back-breaking work. But what you're going to find, if you look long enough, are the components will be there. This relatively small device, just by way of example, what do we think was in that pipe? High explosive or low explosive? Okay, why would you say low? Well, now, previously we saw those pipes with the clocks, and there was a load of dynamite, right? So you can put high explosive inside a pipe. But what this goes to show, low explosives have that threshold of 3,300 feet per second or less, right? So this galvanized steel has just sort of been opened up along the seam. It's been stretched out a little bit, pulled apart, if you will, as opposed to the effects that would occur if that were high explosive, it would be shattered. What you'll find when high explosive is utilized in a device such as this, the pieces will be much smaller, they'll be sharper. It hadn't been stretched apart, it's been shattered from that detonation velocity because it's much higher than the 3,300 feet per second or so that a low explosive would have. But you know, there's the wiring, part of the pipe, it's all in there. If there was a container, you'll find pieces of the container. This is the rear end housing you'll see tomorrow that was at the rear of the Ryder truck McVeigh delivered the device at the Murrah building to. Is that an important piece of evidence? Yeah, basically the confidential vehicle identification number that was recovered from that piece of evidence led us to the Ryder rental facility from which he rented the truck. That's what resulted in this sketch. We then flooded that area with agents from every law enforcement agency available and tied the alias to his true name, and we're looking for him by name because of that piece right there. That's good stuff. What about fingerprints, DNA, all the good stuff that y'all been talking about for the last few days? Is it still in there? Right? You know how you get all wrapped up in something like a Christmas present, you're trying to tape it and you get it all wrapped around your fingers and all that? Good fingerprint stuff, DNA, there's a lot of good forensic evidence left. Hairs and fibers, it's there. And when you're on a scene, you don't know, you can't see it. A lot of it's obviously DNA you're not gonna see. So it's worth gathering, because that might be the one piece of the puzzle down the road, six bombings later, that'll tie everything together. So it's very easy on these big crime scenes to get kind of wrapped up around, you know, sifting the soil and taking paint samples. But don't forget the obvious stuff that every crime scene needs to have. Why collect it? Why gather these pieces and parts together? What are we trying to do? Reconstruct the device. That's right. So the lab, particularly, well, most labs now, have tremendous capacity and abilities. So even if you get a little bit of evidence, it's better than nothing. By the time it quit raining after the bombing in Oklahoma City, what was recovered from one piece of the 15,600 some odd pieces of evidence was basically one prill of ammonium nitrate that was on part of the fiberglass inner lining of that Ryder truck, which had just landed upside down, so it hadn't been washed away by the rain. So had we missed that one piece, you know, there's still plenty of evidence, but that was something pretty critical. It also goes, we talked about the motive. When you start seeing shrapnel, what can you begin to infer? Anti-personnel. Well, who was the target? Once you determine who a specific target was, you can say, well, you know, who dislikes you enough to want to kill you? And, well, gee whiz, you know, I knew a guy once that was had this background or whatever. So it'll help you develop suspects pretty readily. The devices themselves can tell you a lot. Over the years, for the job, I've made a lot of bombs. And after a while, you just kind of learn little shortcuts, the way I'll twist wires, the way I'll solder wires, the types of things I prefer to use just because I'm familiar with them. And that was sort of Ted Kaczynski's undoing. He went as far as he would mill his own parts in his little shed up in the woods. And the things like battery casings that he couldn't, the batteries he couldn't make himself, he would remove the casings from them just because he was thinking about forensics. But when the agents went in to his little shack, they found another device loaded and ready to go under the bed. But it was some unique traits that helped, and plus his manifesto, helped bring him kind of to his own fate. When you're rolling up on a crime scene, it's all about you. The bomb's already gone off. I mean, people are hurt or they're not hurt, but you're there for a mission. You're there for a job. So your individual safety, your personal safety is up to you. I've been on ranges before with experienced bomb techs where there's been a misfire, something happened downrange, and this is a controlled setting. They said, well, you know, we're short on time, let's run ahead and, you know, set the second shot. Well, that's crazy. You know, there are safety protocols in place for us. You know, it's not worth getting hurt over. So while you're, you know, charging down there to the crime scene, the team leader, and we'll talk about some team assignments later, needs to be getting as much information as possible. There was a bank president was kidnapped out east of here, and we got the call. There's supposed to be a radio-controlled device in the car. He kidnapped the bank president. There was a slow-speed chase through like Shawnee, America, and the local police shotgunned the robber in the lap of the banker. So he's covered in blood. He ran out of the car. I interviewed him because, you know, we think there's a bomb. I said, you know, why? Why do you think there's a bomb? He said, well, he showed it to me. Pretty good clue. I said, what'd it look like? Well, there were red sticks, wires, and he had a remote control. So I got the binoculars out, and sure enough, in his shirt pocket, he's lying dead, kind of hanging halfway out of the car, was a remote control. Well, that's a pretty big deal. You know, now what anybody, no one had failed to tell me, or what I had not been told, I should say, was that the car was at the corner of a gas station with, this is Oklahoma, with some oil field storage facilities adjacent to that, under some high transmission, some power lines. And then the media was already let in. They were well inside the perimeter, so they had that big dish up pumping out, what, a lot of RF, right? So there's just no reason to dive right in there. What we did is we pulled everybody back. There are tables established, and the bomb techs and hazmat folks you'll be with can tell you how far back is far enough, particularly when you're looking at underground storage tanks and above ground storage tanks. Move the media way back because that clicker operates on RF. So there's just no need to rush. I mean, personal safety is important. Of course, victims, if there are still people alive, there's a decision to be made. There are rescue workers. Their job's to rescue people. Your job is to investigate the crime. So they're difficult decisions to be made for sure, but we have to keep in mind what we're there for. Intel drives a lot of this. Particularly if you are assigned overseas. There are certain areas, certain zones where, you know, secondary and tertiary devices are commonly used. In those situations, it's not a bad idea to keep a record of where your command post was located last time. Because if I'm the bad guy and I see after the third or fourth device I've laid down, you always park on the corner north and west of the bombing crime scene, guess where my secondary device is going to be? I'm going to put it at that northwest corner. So these are all things we have to think about in advance. Again, from overseas, injury from an engagement that was given at a particular place. Here comes medevac. I mean, who got to pick where that engagement occurred? Bad guys. So they knew where this convoy would stop, so you wait till the most people get there and you fire your second device. Again, this is all pre-planning at this point. Who's in charge? You know, who's going to run the show? who has current control of the crime scene, and if it's a suspected act of terrorism, the Bureau has jurisdictional responsibility, but we count wholly on the associations we have with state and local law enforcement. There are firefighters going to need to be in there. Rescue workers are going to need to be in there. So the chaos that ensues is something that we have to consider early on. What kind of resources will you need? I've said just very briefly, these are protracted crime scenes. How many ERTs will need to be called in? How many security personnel will you need to secure the crime scene overnight? Are you going to work overnight? And then the manager's going to want to know, is there overtime? Who's paying that? And where are all these people going to eat and sleep? What we try to do is not offend the people. I mean, not a way to win friends and influence people, right? We have a lot of resources, and we have a great deal of expertise, but so do other agencies, and so do other outfits. A lot of times we'll show up, and whatever has happened in their backyard. They're going to be emotionally attached, they're going to want to help, and how you make that initial contact is critical and can sometimes dictate how the rest of the crime scene will go. Physically, it doesn't help to have the big command post set up right on the edge of your perimeter. The crime scene will be established, and there's some kind of natural occurrences that tend to happen. Your CP with the bomb techs for a bombing crime scene should be outside the crime scene, but right adjacent to it. That puts you inside a secure perimeter, which encompasses the entire crime scene, and then the command post with the decision makers and all the folks that come along with a large operation like this are physically separated from you. Now, what's critical for that to work is a constant and accurate flow of data from that operational CP that's forward to the command CP, if you will, the command post where the managers are located. That frees you up to concentrate on the job at hand, but generally you're going to have to dedicate somebody, again, set that personnel intensive mode to get information to and from, and usually they're going to want that in person. They don't want a phone call. Information is critical. If you're the third team on a four shift rotation, do you think it'd be helpful for you to know what the team before you found, or kind of what is it we're looking for, So these pre and post search briefings are critical. The weapons, you should be inside that secure perimeter. And again, some of this is perfect world. In a war zone, a secure perimeter may or may not exist. But the tools that are available to us now are sufficiently sophisticated where wearing your weapon on you can actually kind of cause you contamination issues. Assignments, y'all have covered this earlier in the week, I'm sure. Each one is critical. Some of them are a little less glamorous than others. I always hated being the photo log guy, but it's actually pretty critical. Each job has a function. Again, your safety is up to you. If you're, running into a burning building, it'd be a good idea to have some kind of flame retardant clothing on, right? So same thing, you're in a mess like this, there's body fluids, punctures, so steel shank boots. A lot of the guys that were on scene for protracted periods of time at New York are having severe respiratory problems now. They charged in, took care of business, and they ingested some things that are causing them significant health problems now. So the Bureau will get the equipment to you, but you got to put it on. Which gets us, why are we there again? We're looking to solve a crime. And it's just like working any other investigation, We want to know what happened, why it happened, how did it work, and what was the reason. What do you see wrong with control of this crime scene?
There is no reason.
Exactly. And this horror kind of goes on for quite some time. The point being, nobody ever really thinks something's going to go wrong. But you cannot allow yourself to be put in a situation, you know, it's kind of, if it doesn't sound quite right, then you better listen to that voice inside you. The bomb techs that are with you, the bomb squads that are with you, they'll do searches, they'll conduct the sweeps primarily of your area. Remember I said that command post, your command post, is going to be just outside that crime scene. Well, it's a good idea, to me at least, to know if whether or not I'm sitting on top of another device. And that's what the bomb squad can help you do. So there's nothing wrong with asking, has anybody checked our area? You know, there's something good to think of. And again, it's dependent on your situation. But anymore, we can't be too careful. Approaching the crime scene itself, you know, it's a methodic, long-term process. Usually the first folks in, the bombing down at OU a couple of years ago, bomb techs, experienced photographer, and we knew a guy was dead, so we took a medical examiner investigator with us. You don't get a bunch of people just kind of tromping around. You go down and just do what we call an initial assessment. What do we think happened? How big do we kind of estimate the crime scene is going to be? And that helps us factor in the resources we'll need. You know, how big the perimeter, how many people we're going to need to secure it, how many investigators we're going to need, how many ERT personnel. So if we're walking in one way to our, in this case, a target vehicle, how is everyone else going to know where we've been? Well, you mark it with tape. So if nothing else, if I'm the second guy, I'm pretty sure where he's been walking, I'm going to be safe, right? So again, it's convey the information. And we're trying to preserve as much evidence as possible. In an open area, like for a vehicle-borne IED, your crime scene is defined by the farthest piece of evidence. So if we find, you know, a lug nut 150 yards away, then you'll expand that radius by 50%.
How much was that, Barry?
By 50%. 50% for the crime scene. If you find something within that next envelope, what would you do? And how far? 50%. That's good to know. And eventually, you're not going to find anything further, and that'll define the area of the crime scene. Challenge. I'm an accountant, so I like pictures of things, but there it is. 50%, right? So, when you're on the crime scene, once that perimeter's been established, you're in that secure area and you're getting down to work, I mean, it just sort of makes sense that you would recover things that can be lost quickly to either weather, wind, somebody can walk off with things. So we'll try to, in the order of things, I mean, it's just, again, it's a system. It's methodically collect things that can be destroyed or removed as quickly as possible. That's first on your list. Again, I told you quickly about the little rain story we had at Oak Bomb. Swabbing, I mean, there's a whole other class on swabbing. The post-blast course is a 40-hour course now, but generally, the lab would like to have control samples of your swabbing kit. That way they can know if there's something unique to the cotton you're using or the swab you're using, that they don't have to spend a lot of time and money trying to track that down. That came in the kit you had. So a lot of this stuff can be done through your pre-planning. Obviously, you don't want to confuse your pre-planned control samples with what you've collected, so it's recommended that you separate those and keep them separate. That shock front, that positive pressure phase I told you about earlier, what is that doing? It's blowing explosive residue everywhere that it's going, right? So things like street signs, glass that was once, a window at a building, those are just like big catcher's mitts. That's going to collect a lot of data. So you'll use your swabbing kit, and those are really good things to swab. You'll see tomorrow across the street from the Murrah building, there was a no parking sign that was bent at about a 45-degree angle and then bent around the post itself. Well, that was one of the first things we could swab because obviously that had been in the path of that shock front and probably contained some really good explosive residue. So big, flat surfaces, really, really good. But that type of evidence is transient, so we need to consider that first. This kind of makes my head hurt, but you know, you have a 500 milligram Tylenol capsule, measure that down into 12 points beyond the decimal or so. The lab, most lab equipment can detect evidence, particularly explosive residue, in the 100 picogram range. So a little bit goes a long way. You talk about dividing that capsule up into 5 billion pieces. You know, that's not a lot of material. But the lab instruments are sufficiently sophisticated now where that one last swab you take might be the important one. Again, to reiterate, ideally we want to know what the explosive is. There can be some unique properties to it. You know, certain groups use certain things every time. That can give us some clues. So again, go from the most perishable down to the bulk material. Now what we have to consider on these crime scenes is a dramatic increase in the use of extremely sensitive improvised explosives. They're called peroxide-based explosives, tristone triperoxide, and its kind of cousins, HMTD. You're making them in the kitchen sink. They're going to have impurities. The balance may not be correct. They can detonate with anywhere from 60 to 88% the detonation velocity of TNT, but detonation can be caused by change in humidity, heat, friction, shock. So that intel that you should load up on beforehand will tell you how you're going to start collecting samples or if you're just not going to collect them. The event down at OU in 05 and then a subsequent event with a similar material down in Texas City that was just countercharged. It was too hazardous to move. There was no sample taken from certain portions of that because it was simply too hazardous. Can't stress enough how important organization is. If you got 30 people kind of just milling around, it's basically pointless. There are different types of searches that can be utilized. Your team leader can assist with that. The type of scene itself may dictate what type of search you'll do. A line search where designated lanes are established usually works very well in open areas. However, what invariably happens is folks end up about 3 or 4 feet apart. These line searches, when done correctly, you're shoulder to shoulder and hip to hip, walking in a straight line, not some kind of a sine curves type thing, and you're looking. In Lockerbie, Scotland, one of the most critical pieces of evidence was about the size of your thumbnail. And this was over several, I've forgotten the figure, it was acres and acres of search. Well, again, it's intensive, long term, but if you're 4 feet apart, what are the odds of finding something the size of your thumbnail? You know, they approach zero. So again, it's not a lot of fun. Sometimes you're not walking, you're crawling. Again, the importance of the evidence will dictate, you know, to what ends you're going to go. Spiral search, there's a lot of wiggle room in here. If you're the only one out there, then maybe that's the best way to approach it. But a spiral search, there's a lot of room for error. A lot of ground will be missed in a search like that. Grid searches work very, very well. But again, they're labor intensive. It takes a team or two to establish. You need known reference points. These kind of need to be straight. You know, I mean, there's a lot to setting it up. But what's an advantage to a grid search like this when you're in court 5 years later? Very easy to reproduce. Once it's established, you can consider aerial photos, and it'll give a jury a pretty good depiction of kind of what happened, as opposed to, well, I started and walked around in kind of a spiral circle that may or may not have found everything, right? So again, it's just systematic. What are we looking for? Anything that doesn't belong there. You know, at the time of a bombing, there's really no way for you to know what the device was. You can generally tell what the target was because that's the thing that's going to be destroyed, right? But it's difficult to determine if wiring you collect is part of a car or part of the bomb. We had, I think there's a photo of it in here, Ford gave us an identical Ryder truck identical to the one McVeigh used in the bombing here, so that we could tell, well, that's just part of the truck as opposed to part of the device. So an identical vehicle is common. It's a boring, dirty job, but there's some good stuff in there. Particularly, you know, larger crime scenes, if there's a device here, are you going to use sifting screens? Well, you know, you might have the ceiling fall in, carpet, you know, you might have stuff to sift. But it's going to be nothing like the crater that you'll find at a large vehicle bomb. But generally, you want to use at least a couple of different sizes of mesh. What's the point there? Find smaller stuff, right? So you sift it once, sift it twice, and eventually you'll find the bits and pieces. I think I heard Wes speaking earlier. You'll generally try to keep like stuff together. You know, parts of cars go with parts of cars. Parts of the device go with parts of device. Wires go with wires. And ideally, you'll have one from each grid. Again, I mentioned those really boring jobs, the photo log recorder guy. That's the key to the Ryder truck that delivered the bomb to the Murrah Building. And, you know, why is that important? Well, Timothy McVeigh had approached Michael Fortier and asked him to assist in the bombing. Fortier chose not to do it. He also chose not to tell anybody about it, but he chose not to participate. So once he was persuaded that it was in his best interest to testify against McVeigh, the obvious defense would be he's going to say whatever's necessary to get the best deal from the government. So it was important for the Bureau to establish Fortier's veracity. What he told us was McVeigh's plan was to drive the truck up, walk diagonally across the street to a little alleyway behind the Y where his getaway car was parked. Well, this key was found at the corner of the alleyway down from which we think he had parked the getaway car. Well, that went to support Fortier's story. But this was located among those 15,663 pieces of evidence in a plastic bag marked miscellaneous metal. So the other bomb tech, Jim Norman, went through the 250,000 photographs and found that picture. Well, then we went to the photo log and saw who took the photograph. From that, we went to the team logs, what team they were on, went to the team log, see what evidence they collected, and I was able to go to the shelf in the warehouse, pull out that bag of miscellaneous metal, and in it was the key that drove the bomb. So life would have been a lot easier if you know you're looking for a Ford key, or the bomb was delivered in a Ford product. You find one, if it's important, label it separately. Don't, you know, we shouldn't kind of just junk things in. That's with the vehicle that Ford gave us to assist. As far as marking evidence, you'll see tomorrow, for instance, in that large differential housing, you can mark it directly, but we have to kind of be careful where we're putting those marks. We might be destroying that forensic evidence we discussed earlier. So, you know, kind of common sense can dictate what you do there. Small items, you know, too small to mark, put them in a package, mark those. What we've learned kind of the hard way sometimes is at least get a couple of names as people that have recovered the evidence. You know, generally through the ERT protocols, there'll be the guy that finds it, and then the team leader may come also, something that's obviously critical, because what if something happens to the one person? You know, if they die, retire, move to, you know, Haiti, whatever, you know, then what? So if you got two people's names, your odds go up, you know, by 100%, right, of having somebody around for trial. Complex cases, which a lot of the large vehicle bombings will be, it's helpful to know that, you know, Bob Smith works for this police department, and you can read his name and know how to contact him down the road. You know, one of these indecipherable signatures with no other data really is just no help at all. It's not worth doing. Collection, again, it's a whole nother animal. Just be aware that when you stick something metallic in a unknown white powder, it could explode. So you might want to rethink your plan. If you're not really sure what it is or how to collect it, you know, call the lab, get with hazmat, get with the bomb techs. You know, you're none of us knows everything. It's a team effort, and there's a lot of information out there that's available to you. But don't just dive in and start scooping stuff up. There have been times when the evidence response team has called me and said, hey, we understand you've cleared this facility. We're going to go ahead and start collecting X, Y, and Z. and I've never heard of where they are and don't know what they're talking about, and what they were about to collect was triacetone triperoxide. And some of the tools we use, for instance, drug test kits can cause that to detonate. So again, intel driven, and use your best judgment. Packaging, you know, ideally you'll remove a sample of particularly like liquids, remove it from the bulk. Remember how sensitive that lab equipment is. You know, don't send a gallon of something into them. They don't like that. They're looking for very, very small amounts, and particularly if it's something that can off-gas, they may not even open the container. They can just puncture that, take a sample of the air from within, and test it that way. Ton of stuff you've heard about all 2 weeks you've been here. If you're looking for vapor residue, good idea to have something that seals and doesn't allow vapors to escape. So you got to think in advance, you know, what do you want in the laboratory to do, and send it to them in such a way that they're able to do it. If you put something that off-gases in a porous bag, like a Ziploc, what's going to be in there when it gets to the lab? A lot of nothing, probably. So you kind of have to think, you know, what do we want to get out of this deal? Why are we sending it to the lab, and make sure it gets to them in the proper fashion? If you don't know, all you got to do is ask. They'll be happy to tell you. Again, this kind of thing's more for LVB, the larger crime scenes. You know, why do we want samples of dirt? It's a pretty good, it'll hold that explosive residue pretty well. So we want something from inside the crater, ideally, about enough to fill a 35 millimeter film canister. Then you want something a few feet away, and then you want something from completely outside the area, but, you know, not like Arkansas. We're trying to develop a baseline. So you'll find this is what the dirt looks like without anything introduced into it. So we have a pretty high degree of certainty that the explosive had, you know, whatever type of chemical composition. Crime scene, just like when you leave a search warrant, we need to hand it over officially. You know, we're done, we're leaving, we're not coming back, and we need to record, you know, who's now in charge, because it's no longer us. That should be a matter of kind of your last piece of documentation. I do want to point out, when you show up on a crime scene like this, if you find an explosive component, you know, I've shown you some pictures, you know, call somebody else. A blasting cap, we do a lot of demos for citizens academies and other police academies. You know, a blasting cap, for instance, can blow your hand off, can blind you. So you kind of know what they look like, even if you're not sure, and you think, you know, remember where it was, back out, and call in the bomb squad, because it's just because it's small doesn't mean it's not hazardous.